session is called Leading by Listening, and the inspiration is your debrief conversations with the kids that you're leading on these explore trips. So why don't we start by you talking about what's when you have a good debrief conversation with one of your explorers, what's it like? How do we know when it's a good conversation?
When they actually just
they're engaged.
When they're not sleeping.
Yeah, they're not sleeping. There's a signal. It reminds me, a young poet invited Carl Sandburg to his poetry reading, and Carl Sandburg fell asleep. And the young poet said, "Mr. Sandburg, you fell asleep in my poetry reading, and I was hoping to get your opinion." Sandburg said, "Sleep is an opinion." What else? How else do we know when a debrief is good? It's a good debrief for a while.
Leads to your discussion.
Yeah, say more about that.
It doesn't kind of follow a framework. It's sort of everyone sort of at the same time agrees at like a specific point is something that they all want to talk about. So
you got to figure out what they want to talk about, and when that emerges, people are in it. Good. What else? It's a good debrief when.
I don't know, I thought a good debrief sticks with you afterwards, like the coming weeks and stuff too. Because you can always be there in the moment, but if it doesn't carry forward afterwards, then it's almost like a faux good debrief.
Yeah, a faux good debrief. What are you doing? What are you doing in your conversations with these young people that seems to be inviting good stuff out of them? What have you learned about how to engage them?
Prompting with questions.
Yeah, the open-ended questions.
Open-ended questions. So tell me about that.
So not leading them to a certain answer, or just yes or no.
Mm-hmm. And why do you suppose we ask yes and no questions?
Make it easier.
We're projecting.
Say more about that.
No.
Say more about that.
Assuming that we know the answer before we listen.
Sam, would you play a quick game with me?
Sure.
Okay, so you and I are going to ignore everybody else and try to forget that they're here, all right? Let's just do a little mind trick with me. The game is I'm going to give you three words, a three-word story, and I want you to ask me whatever you want. And I will answer your questions. You're going to get the story from me, figure out the story. And when you do, come on down here, actually. We're going to get easier. When you get the story, you're going to tell the story to the rest of the group, all right? So this is a three-word story. I'm going to give you three words. You can ask me anything you want. You want to get the story so you can tell it to your colleagues. You ready? Okay, forget them. You're right here with me. Scattered items returned.
Are the items bought?
No.
What made them be scattered?
There was an accident.
Where are you returning them?
To the people who own them.
Are you returning them?
Yes.
Are the items broken?
Some of them.
Are the items edible?
Some of them.
Are the items from a store?
I guess originally some of them.
Because everything's from the store.
It's at some point.
Okay.
Except if it's not.
Okay. Yes. Are you getting refunded for returning these?
No. Let's give him a hand. Have a seat. Do
I need to tell the story now?
No, not yet. We're going to get you some help. Okay? So just jump in. You can jump in wherever. What's your name?
Scott.
Scott. Welcome.
Okay. How are they scattered?
They were scattered by an accident.
What time in the morning? I mean, what time in the day?
You know, it was close to midnight.
Close to midnight.
Mm-hmm.
They were being transported?
No.
How were they contained?
They weren't contained. They were scattered all over the neighborhood.
Were they contained at any point?
Yeah, they were in the house.
In the house?
Yeah, they were in the house.
How did they get out of the house?
The accident scattered them all over the neighborhood.
What was the accident?
The house blew up.
What were the items that were scattered?
Household items. let's give Scott a hand. Good job. Thank you very much. Join me. Yeah, this happens at Acton all the time. Y'all having a full-fledged Acton experience.
Carolina.
Pleasure. My pleasure. Stephen.
Why did you buy the items?
I didn't buy the items.
Who bought them?
The people who own the house, I guess.
Tell me about the people who own the house.
They were neighbors. They lived two blocks over from us. People didn't like them.
Why did people like them?
I guess they kept to themselves. Nobody thought they were very friendly.
Why do you think they kept to themselves?
You know, I think we learned more about that afterwards.
After what?
After we brought some of the stuff back to them.
What did you bring back to them?
Well, I brought a ring back to them that I found behind my house.
Tell me about the ring.
It was a small kind of brass ring with a little blue stone in it. I knew it wasn't ours, and you know, since the accident, I was looking for things. So I took it over to where they were staying.
What was their reaction when you brought them the ring?
The ring belonged to one of the grandmother's old boyfriends.
Tell me more about that.
Well, the thing is that she had wanted to marry this guy, but he'd been killed in war. Mm-hmm. And so she told us about that. And I guess I'd never thought of her as somebody who would be in love.
Mm. How did that make you feel?
It made me feel like, wow, there's a lot about these people I didn't know. And maybe why did I not like them before?
Mm. Did you feel closer to her?
Yes.
What happened after that? How did your relationship change?
Yeah, let's get Caroline. What's the point of that silly game? What's the point of that silly game?
Follow-up questions. Follow-up questions.
So say more about that.
Digging deeper, like getting them to talk about what they want to talk about instead of just one or two word responses.
And how do you know what question to ask? What's your name?
Aaron.
Aaron, how do you know what question to ask next?
It's related to what you're listening and it's related to what they're saying.
My grandmother, bless her heart, so wise, this woman. She had all these little things she would say. One of my favorite ones was, people are always trying to teach you how to love them. Isn't that good? I'm going to say it again. People are always trying to teach you how to love them. What if that's true? What if that really is true? Of course it is. But what if it's true? Then what difference does that make when we meet somebody, when we have a conversation with somebody? What difference does that make? If it's true that people are always trying to teach you how to love them, those kids are trying to teach you how to love them. They're trying to teach you, which means the first question is, are you willing to learn? Here's a little story. My priest mentor sent me in my 30s to be a chaplain at St. David's Hospital. Now, I'm a business professor at the University of Texas, and he tells me, you're going to go be a chaplain at St. David's Hospital this summer. I said, why? He said, because I think this may be the only way to save your soul. I said, I don't have any idea why I'm doing this, but because you told me, I will. So I took the summer off. I enrolled in clinical pastoral education. I spent the morning sitting in a room with priests, debriefing conversations that we had the previous day in the hospital, and I spent the afternoon going around St. David's Hospital, going to people's rooms who were sick or dying, and being with them. I was coming out of a hospital room, like the second week I'm at St. David's Hospital, and my supervisor, who is this very tough German lady with very austere gray hair, she met me on the way out of the room and she said, "You are awful." I said, No, I'm not awful. She said, yes, you are probably the worst chaplain we have had at St. David's Hospital. I said, but I'm doing everything I can to try to bring comfort to the patients. She says, you talk too much. You're giving them advice. You're trying to fix them. The patients are exhausted. And the only relief they are getting is when you leave the room. I said, how do I get better at this? She said, I don't think you're going to get any. I just don't think you're any good at this. I said, I'm here for another 3 months, so you better give me something to try or I'm going to go out a window. She said, she thought for a long time, and then she said, you know, I think you're probably a good teacher. I hear people say that about you, and I believe that's probably true. She goes, the thing you haven't figured out, Stephen, is that the patients don't need a teacher. They don't want a teacher. They want someone who is willing to learn what their life is like. I said, that never occurred to me. She said, it is very clear that that has never occurred. She said, I think that the question, though, is, are you interested in being with people that way? You know what? You know, we have investments, don't we, in how we be with people. The way we be with people is an expression of how we what we trust. And being a teacher was a very safe posture for me, because I got to be the smart one. I got to be the guy who knew things. I got to be wise. I got to... The idea of going in the room to be a student and learn from them felt a lot riskier to me. I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't know how this was going to play out. I couldn't control it. And I couldn't necessarily get the payoff that I was used to getting that I wanted. Now, what does that story have to do with what you're doing?
Well, we're the adults, like, in our interactions with the explorers, but so we want to take that control. We want to take that powerful role, but that's not what they're wanting, probably.
Well, my personal experience with volunteering is I always go in and kind of, I guess, thinking, you know, like, I want to help. And in the end, I'm the one who actually, I think, probably, I mean, maybe not gets the most out of it, but it's amazing how much I realize that I'm, like, getting helped by the experience or by the people that I'm interacting with.
Why do we want to help? Why do we want to help?
I mean, sometimes I think we have an opinion that we know what they need and that we're going to come in and give them what they need.
That's just good.
It makes you feel good. It makes you feel good. Sometimes it makes you feel safe. Sometimes it pays off in some other way. So I had to become suspicious. Maybe we have to become suspicious of this impulse to help people. Because out of that comes, doesn't necessarily come listening. You know, would you rather be helpful or would you rather be surprised? Would you rather be helpful or would you rather receive what they're trying to give? What does it mean to truly engage these folks in a way that's going to be rich and powerful? So the game we just played, there's three rules. You've named two of them. One is ask open-ended questions. The second is follow the clues. And when you're following clues, you're often keying on, what are the key words I just heard? Where's the energy in what they just said? And then open the door. Tell me about that. Accident, what kind of accident? What happened next? You didn't like them. Why not? What did you think about it? Huh? How did that happen? Because when I'm sitting here, you could almost see. When I'm sitting here and someone's asking me closed questions like, was it night? Was it Christmas? Was it from a store? Did you hear the noise? I'm dying. Because this story is inside of me exerting intense hydraulic pressure to get out. And you're giving me this tiny little straw to pass stuff through. And what I want to do is tell you a story, because I need you to hear it. That's how I want to connect with you. I'm trying to teach you how to love me. And if you are troubleshooting, or hypothesis testing, or driving from your assumptions, or trying to be helpful, then I am stuck. Make sense? Okay, let's try again. I'm gonna tell you a three-word story. And y'all can work as a group, and let's just take our time. Airport, lady, trash can.
What is she doing at the trash can?
That was her job. She was cleaning up.
What if we just started with, can you tell me what happened?
See what happens, because I might not tell you immediately, right?
Yeah.
What are you doing at the airport?
Coming home from a vacation.
What happened at the airport?
I saw this lady with a trash can.
What was the expression on her face?
At first she seemed scared, but then she seemed, I don't know, like she was glad to see me.
Why do you think she was glad to see you?
I don't know that she was glad to see me, but I think she wanted me to know that it was okay. I think she saw that I was scared. I think she saw I was scared.
What were you scared of?
I didn't speak the language. I couldn't talk to these people.
Where were you coming from?
I was coming from Italy, coming home.
Where's home?
Oklahoma. Does this not sound a little bit like something you might get from one of your kids? Stay with me.
What did you think of the lady?
We've been on a long vacation with my family.
Can you tell me more about your trip?
Yeah, we went to all these different places. My parents took me to this museum. We went to the beach one day.
What did you learn at the museum?
I don't know. It wasn't that interesting.
What was your favorite part of the trip?
I liked when we were at the beach. There was this place right on the beach, and we ate a lot of pizza. I loved that. And the guy there was real friendly.
So did you like the pizza, the beach, or the guy more?
I don't know. It was a good day.
Seems like the lady at the airport was important to you somehow. Why?
Now notice, what if he hadn't said why?
He just said yes.
Right.
Sometimes a question is just a statement, like when Terry Gross says to Keith Richards in his interview, this book is really about your mother. Keith Richards said, yeah, I'll tell you about that. You don't have to ask a question. Sometimes you can just say something. Seems like the lady at the airport was important. Yeah. Yeah. It was kind of weird.
What was weird about it?
At first I thought she was scared of me. But then it was like she wanted me to know that it was okay.
Why do you think she's scared of me?
I don't know. I'm kind of big. I don't know, sometimes people are scared of me.
Say more about that.
Oh, you know, you can tell sometimes the way people look at you. Whether they think you're okay or not.
Have you felt that before?
Sometimes.
Does it happen in school?
No.
Do you feel okay?
Yeah. I feel okay.
Why?
I mean, you know, my friends, my parents, I'm okay. This lady, though, was good.
Did you try to help her?
No.
Did she do anything other than smile at you?
Not really. I think, you know, she could tell I wanted to put something in the trash can. It was silly.
Did you want to put something in the trash can?
Yeah.
Can you tell me about that?
That was just a gum wrapper.
Were you by yourself?
Yeah. Yeah, I was by myself.
How did that make you feel?
I didn't know where my parents were. I couldn't understand people.
Why couldn't you understand them?
You know, they were talking. I don't know their language.
How did you find your parents?
They came up later. I don't know where they were. I told them, you know, don't mess with me like that.
What did your parents say?
I don't know. They could tell that something had happened. I was mad at them. I told them about that lady, though.
What did you say to them?
I said, that lady, That lady told me I could put my wrapper in her trash can. I don't know. It was just, it seemed different. It was weird.
Did that interaction remind you of something that has happened previously?
No. Let's stop here. How are we doing?
I still don't get it. How
do you not see the Lincoln
home?
He said he was coming home.
Was it an airport?
I thought he was coming back. Oh, I missed that.
What's the point of this silly game?
He listened to what's going on and asked questions that have to do with what you were saying. So make sure you're fully engaged.
What were some of the questions you heard that got the best, or the best thing happened? What were some of the best questions we just asked?
How did it make you feel?
How did that make you feel?
Right.
That question, what do we think about that question? How did that make you feel?
It's too vague and scares people.
That's a hard question. I'm a 55-year-old guy who thinks about this stuff all the time, and I can't usually answer that question.
It's asking something specific, but that's not about, it's something specific that, like, what was her, the expression on her face? Like, you might not, that doesn't immediately go to, you know, you're not asking a 12-year-old how does that make you feel, but it kind of opens up maybe a little bit more of an expansive response.
What were some of the good questions we asked y'all? Think with me about this. This is how we get.
Why did you feel that way?
Why questions are hard, I think. Mm-hmm. I think questions like, in general, how questions are easier to answer than why questions. But questions about feelings are hard to ask and answer. I'm gonna tell you how I feel. You can tell how I feel. How did I feel?
Scared.
How did you know I was scared?
You said.
I said that word a couple of times. You can tell by the tone of my voice. You can tell whether I'm looking at you. You can tell about words that I'm using, how I felt. If you're willing to see how I felt, I will show you. If you have to ask me though, it's gonna get hard, right? So, think about some other questions we just asked that made this conversation go deeper.
Your favorite parts of the trip.
What was your favorite part of the trip? I'm always going to have an answer to that. Yeah, what did you like? What did you like? What was fun? Right?
I like the, it seemed important, the lady in the trash can.
The lady in the trash can seems important.
Kind of
thank you. Yeah, she's showing me that you hear what I'm saying. The lady in the trash can is important. Just saying that, yeah, she is important. It was weird. So, when you hear a kid say something that's imprecise and vague, like it was weird, it was strange, it was, just follow that. What was weird? What was weird? What was strange? What did you see? What happened? What was that like?
So this has happened to me before where I make an assumption and it's right and it opens up the conversation because he was actually listening to you and it affirmed you. But if you make a bad assumption, then it could close somebody off. So how do you recover from that?
Sounds like the lady with the trash can was important. And he's going to say, I don't think she was that important. Then he'll start over. But the fact that you're trying is going to be what gets me to try again. If I see that you're trying to learn from me, I'm going to keep trying. Because that didn't happen very often.
Sometimes just in life, I try to say things like, I get the sense that X, Y, Z, is that right? So I'm just like feeling the water. Is that a good technique?
You know, I think that the willingness to show someone you're listening and try to get it is really an important part of these conversations. I try to make it as simple as I can. If kids feel like I'm trying to use a lot of language, then it feels like it's about me, and if they think I'm trying to use tricks, then it's over. So I think just make it as simple as you can and say, that lady sounds important. Stop. I don't like follow-up questions like, is that right? Do I get it? Why? Because it's just adding extra words. The kid will tell you if you get it or not. You don't need the extra effort. That lady sounds important. Stop, which is a way of saying, I hear you, I love you, I am open. What do I need to know? And you say it without asking, just by showing me you're listening. There was a guy I was flying by. I couldn't do this for the life of me. And the summer in the hospital was just torture. Eventually, because I followed her advice, she said, I would put my hand on the door before I went in and said, am I willing to learn from this person? Not help them, not be a good chaplain, not anything, but am I willing to learn from this person? And I had to decide, I wanted to learn from these folks. And that is not an easy thing to decide if you already think you're good, right? If you're about protecting yourself. But if I want to learn something about what your life is like, I have to cultivate that curiosity in myself. I have to decide that's what I'm about. Because if you're about anything else, they're going to know it. So I spent the whole summer trying to do that. I put my hand on the door. Do I want to learn from this person? If the answer was no, I hid out in the bathroom. If the answer was yes, I'd go in and I'd just keep saying to myself, I'm here to learn. I want to learn. What's her life like? What is his life like? The other day, this weird thing happened on an airplane. This weird experience on an airplane.
What was the weird experience?
I sat next to this guy. He was in work denim and a hat pulled down over his eyes, big bushy black beard. And on the tray table in front of him were three empty vodka bottles. And we were still at the gate. And I thought, I better find something to read. So I started looking through my briefcase for something to read. And then all of a sudden, it was like I heard this voice, and it said, this man is telling you something. And I thought, yeah, and I'm not that interested in hearing. And the voice came back and said, this is life. This man is telling you something. You're sitting beside him on an airplane. He has the empty vodka bottles, and he is telling you something. And I didn't think, it wasn't about thinking, it was just all of a sudden there was this choice. And I turned to him without thinking and I said, flying is scary. That's what came out. I don't even remember formulating that thought, it just arrived. He said, yeah. I said, what are you scared of? And this man turned, and at first it was this sort of suspicious look, and then it was sort of a, is this real? And then it was this sort of relaxed look, and he said, I'm afraid my kids are growing up without me. I said, tell me about your kids. And this guy starts talking. We are flying to Chicago. The plane has taken off by now. He stops, he doesn't order any more to drink. He tells me about his father, who was absent growing up. He tells me about a friend of his who died in the oil fields. He tells me about his wife, whom he's afraid is not, you know, maybe has found someone else. And when we got off the airplane, we stood up to get our bags, and this man, with no invitation, hugged me and said, that helped. And I said, without thinking, yeah, that helped. See what I'm saying? I didn't intend to do that. I didn't want to do that. Right? What does this have to do with what we're trying to do with our kids? What does this have to do with what you're going to be doing with your kids?
Seeing an opportunity
when it comes. And be willing to step into some uncomfortable places because there's conversations that you don't necessarily want to have, but sometimes they need to be had, and just we're all here to help. And if you just kind of let your instincts take over, sometimes you just help without realizing.
Yeah, and listen to the nonverbal communication that they're putting out there.
How would your conversation with your kids be different if you weren't there to help, but you were there to learn? How would the conversations with the kids be different if the purpose of this program was a learning opportunity for you?
You would ask more questions about the stuff you like don't, you can't relate to.
Like what?
Stuff that is from their own life and not yours.
You enter their world, yeah, as opposed to making that come to yours.
What are some conversations we might have with kids if we decided that what we really wanted to talk about was stuff we didn't know, we didn't understand, we wanted to learn, we wanted to see, we wanted to be able to experience something of what their life is like? What are some of the conversations we might have with them?
What's your family like?
School.
Yeah, what's it like? What's school like? What else?
Who are your friends? Like, who are your friends? How do you get along with your friends?
Yeah.
What are those relationships?
What do you like to do?
What do you like to do?
What's challenging to you?
Yeah, what's hard? What do you like to do? What else? I love it. Sorry?
I was saying, like, what are the pressures you feel?
Yeah. Yeah. Tell me about school. What's it like? What do you like? What's the best part? What's the good part of it? What do you look forward to? What's hard? Tell me about that. What do you wish? What do you wish would happen? What's a good day like? The best day at school, what's that like?
What's the lunch food like?
What's the lunch food like? Yeah. What do y'all eat there? What's that like? Do you know the answer to that? I don't. And suddenly I want to know. One of the ways we make ourselves curious is we start to imagine the questions we might ask people. Like I might ask you, well, what's the best part of being with these kids? What's the part you really enjoy? What's the part that's awkward? When do you feel like it was really, when did you really feel connected to a kid? Remember a time you really felt connected? What was that like? What happened? What happened next? Right? What have you learned from these kids what have you learned? What difference has it made for you? The fact that you spend time with these kids, what happens in the rest of your life? See, I'm interested in that. But it's not until I start asking the questions that I feel the curiosity engaging. Before that, I'm the guy at the front of the room that's supposed to be an expert. And if I relate to you that way, this is going to be a very long hour. You see what I'm saying? That's a very limited way to be with people. I have this friend, he's a theologian. His name is Samuel Wells. He's the head of St. Martin in the Fields Church in London, which is the big church in Trafalgar Square. And he's a super smart guy. He used to be a community organizer. He's doing some really innovative stuff to help refugees and homeless people in central London. And he's got a church that's a bunch of, smart activist people. He's a really good leader. And I ask him, how do you come up with all these ideas that seem to work? These community engagement things that you do, where do you get that? And he said, I used to think a lot about working for people, helping, working for them. And I ran out of ideas. So now I'm really focused on how to be with people. He says, the faith that I have about the way the world works is it's about being with before you work for. Because when I'm working for people, I'm working out of my ego. I'm usually working on my stuff. I'm usually doing stuff to people. He says, but if I'm being with people to find out what happens when we're together. Here's another thing that is interesting. There's a kid on the sidewalk in front of my house, about 6 years old, and there's this big guy with long, kind of gray, stringy hair coming up the sidewalk. It's a guy I've seen in the park. I think he sleeps there sometimes. And he's coming up the sidewalk, and there's this kid in the grass in the sidewalk in the front of my house playing with a bug. And this homeless guy has come down the street, and I'm thinking, do I need to get out there and make sure everybody's okay? And I decided, wait. The homeless guy comes up beside the kid, and goes down to his haunches, and he looks over the kid's shoulder in the grass, and through the window I can hear him say, cool bug. And the kid says something which I can't hear. And the guy said, what's he doing with that stick? And the kid says, and the guy said, he's got green horns. And the kid says, and after like about 90 seconds, the guy stands up and he says, well, see ya.
So a question about being with them. How much of this is full-on questions versus your own self-disclosure? Because I feel like when I'm with people, I have a better connection with them when I'm too sharing. So what's that balance?
What do you think about that?
So I'm talking to a kid and he's talking about his mom. Maybe you have an experience with your mom, right? What are you gonna do?
I think it depends on the topic.
Yeah.
There are certain things that I'm willing to share with my kids about family life. I would have no issue with that. About drugs and alcohol, like not they're 12 right now, so maybe not yet with that, and maybe ask more questions. So I think it's topic specific, but yeah, we definitely open up with our kids a lot.
Awesome.
I can acknowledge it. Say, I've had issues with my mom, or I've spoken to my mom. Give him some so that he knows that you're hearing, and then ask him a question, and so that he knows that you're consciously understanding, or that you're actively listening to what he's saying, and they can relate to him, and they can ask him more questions. And then if he wants to know more about your story, he'll ask.
I think this is the key.
Yeah.
If he wants to know more about your story, he'll ask.
Mm-hmm.
So if you signal a willingness by saying, yes, you know, I hear what you're saying. And, you know, we don't want to, the thing is, when do we offer that piece about ourselves, and what do we do next? And I am not going to offer that piece about myself until the kid is finished telling me everything they want to tell me. And at that point, I'm going to make a decision. Does letting them know that I have had similar experience or a relevant experience, is that going to help? Or am I opening the conversation or am I closing it? So it's not going to be something I offer early, because if I'm offering it early, I'm always feeling like I'm either trying to help, trying to make the conversation less awkward. Awkward is good. If it's awkward for you, it's working. Okay? That means you're not in control. The kid, we're not trying to make things easy. We're not trying to take the discomfort out of the conversation. We're trying to show them that discomfort is how we get somewhere, and that we are courageous and not afraid of discomfort. So don't start talking if you're uncomfortable. And if you do, say one short thing, kind of the one sentence game. Then I think your colleague up here is very wise.
Mm-hmm.
If you say, yeah, I can, what you're saying me reminds me that things were tough with my mom too, stop.
Mm-hmm.
And then the kid may say nothing for 3 days. And then he might come back later and say to you, what was your mom like?
Mm-hmm.
And then at that point, our goal here has to be simply, it's almost like a chess game. Put the piece on the table and see what their next move is.
Mm-hmm.
And you're doing it in love, and you're doing it for the sake of things unfolding. But if you feel inside you that you're being driven to disclose, that you're starting to kind of vomit, then just stop.
Mm-hmm.
Just stop. Don't take over. Let the kid ask you questions. And then a moment might come where you tell a story. That's cool. Telling a story is cool. It's one that you think in the moment, I'm telling this story because that's what's next in this conversation. Awkward's good. Silence is what trust sounds like. And for you to show kids that you can be with them and be quiet and not have to talk, that's a pretty powerful thing. That's why you show somebody that they're okay. I don't have to talk around. How to control things. We're going to wrap here. You want to ask any questions? Sir?
So we have one kid in particular who doesn't talk at all. And I feel like I don't know a lot if I start asking any type of question. I mean, this is kind of making me feel like I'm not asking the right questions, but it's just been really hard to engage him. And I don't know. I'm comfortable with silence. Like if we have we're driving to our spot for the day on Saturday, that's okay. We don't have to talk. But I don't feel like he'll talk at all if we don't kind of try to make him. So I'm trying. It's been hard to engage with him. I'm trying to figure out how to do it.
What do y'all think about that?
So are you asking how to get the ball rolling? In a sense?
Yeah. So, I mean, I know about his family life. I know about, I don't know. He doesn't talk.
I think some people take time, like even longer than you would think. Like
yeah.
I had a first grader that didn't talk an entire year, and then like my last session with him, like he just like decided like I was worthy of his trust,
yeah.
And it was like a floodgate. So I would almost say just consistency and like letting him come to it in his own terms, but.
Letting him know that you care about him, that you're here whenever, on his terms, it's like, whenever you're ready to talk, I'll be here.
Yeah, sometimes we're priming the pump. So if I see this kid, he doesn't usually talk, I'm gonna say, I'm glad you came today.
Yeah.
I was looking forward to seeing you.
Yeah.
That's watering. Then maybe you offer something. And then the point of the bug story is what? What's the point of the bug story? How did the homeless guy and the six-year-old kid have a two-minute intense friendship? Because that seems like a miracle, doesn't it? How did that happen?
You let it evolve.
Well, I stayed out of it. Thank goodness. That one really messed it up. What else?
It took interest in the kid. Someone just going.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a bug. You got to find a bug. Whatever this kid is looking at is the beginning of the conversation.
Yeah.
It's like, what do you think that wolf is doing?
Right.
Or, what are you seeing? You know?
He also literally came to his level.
He totally came to his level. Literally. He just came down. He came down to join the communion in progress. Yeah, there is communion in progress. Let's join it. Yeah, anytime you're trying to take over or corral people or get them on your agenda, then that's disruptive. But if you're willing to, being with people is about joining communion in progress. The kid and the bug are having a day, and I just came to join that. And the kid will let you in because it's about the bug, but it's not really. Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, the author of The Little Prince, says, love is not looking into each other's eyes, but looking at something together. And I think that's how we love kids, right? Is that we find what they're looking at, and we have the best material, don't we, to work with. We got the whole world that we're taking them out into. And I think if we're patient to show them that we're not trying to get our stuff out of this, this is not about meeting our needs. This is about we're here to learn from them, and we're interested in what they're interested in and their experience, because that's good. Can we have like 3 minutes? Can we try one more?
You said there were three.
Oh, there's three. The third one is listen with your whole self. And in the game, that's when you get this, your body language. Lean in, look, nod, say the word again. Embody the curiosity, right? If you just start by nodding your head and leaning closer, then you will listen in a different way. Whereas if I'm back here, or here, or here, whatever, then it's like my body isn't helping me listen. Your body listens, so engage it, all right? Last thing. Let's be thoughtful, okay? That was fun today.
What'd you like about it?
I liked it when we got wet.
How'd you get wet?
Well, we were trying to get across the creek, but, you know, John was pushing people.
What do you think about John?
I like getting wet.
Are you a swimmer?
No, I don't get to swim. But it's really fun to be in the water.
Did you go all the way under?
No, but I got my pants wet up to here.
Is your mom angry?
I don't know. I'll probably be dry when we get home, don't you think?
What was your favorite part of today?
I thought when we were all in the water and people were like, it was kind of like, you know, it's like we could break the rules for a little bit.
Did John push you?
Yeah, but I pushed him back.
Do you have a lot of rules at home?
You know, there's all, you know, yeah.
Rules?
What's your least favorite rule?
I like to. I like it when I can eat what I like.
Me too.
What do you like?
I love avocado.
Yuck.
What do you like to eat?
I like pizza.
What's your favorite pizza?
I like pepperoni best, but I like almost any kind.
From where? From where?
We have a Domino's over by our house, and sometimes when we get pizza, I get to go. I get to go pick it up with my mom.
So, one of your favorite times with your mom?
How are we doing today? How are we doing now? This feels a little different than the beginning of the class to me. What are you taking from this discussion that might help you in your conversations with the kids?
Just following your lead.
Never asking a yes or no question again.
You break that habit quickly if you decide that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
Assume the answer is yes and ask the follow-up question.
Yeah.
This thing about following the lead, that's not just a technical thing. That's a spiritual thing. That's an adaptive leadership thing. You have to decide that you want to follow their lead because that's where it is. The thing you're trying to get to, they are going to lead you to it. And if you start being curious and practicing this curiosity before you're with them, think about the things you want to know. Not to be helpful, the things you want to know because their life experience is so different from yours. That by letting that in and being informed by it, you're going to get what you want from this experience that you haven't even articulated yet. You don't really know why you're doing this, and you're going to find out when you let them lead you to it. Thank y'all. This is fun. I enjoyed it.